Now I'm no longer held back by games I recorded 3 years ago, next is the first game I recorded for the show in 2021, Sphinx and the Cursed Mummy. My grandmother had this on the Xbox back when it was new, so I got to watch her play it quite a bit. This is the Switch version I'm recording, apart from displaying in HD I don't think there are many significant differences. I only played certain parts that she had trouble with, and those moments were few, so this is my first time playing the game through myself. When we start the game, our first scene is this old monkey guy telling two of us that some prophesied darkness will soon descend on them and they need to prepare. These two are his most worthy apprentices, Sphinx, the player character, and some bird guy, Horus. Then my recording corrupted mid-sentence for a bit. What you're missing is Imhotep, the master, saying he will transport them to the land of Uruk where they will need to find the blade of Osiris. When the footage comes back in, he's teleporting them. A huge castle can be seen in the distance, the castle of Uruk. Then I get another slight corruption which cuts back in as he points out the glowing beam in the sky. That should be the last time that happens. The light protects the castle and surrounding area. While there will be traps and obstacles around, Imhotep says that the ray is the most dangerous. Beyond this point, his powers don't work, so he'll have to leave us to it, saying on his way out that we'll need to work together to find the blade of Osiris. Horus thinks he sees something in a rock structure nearby and says in the meantime I should check out this area. Right now I have no form of attack, I can only jump and pick things up. First thing I find is a plant that explodes in my face as I get near. I just run forward a bit and climb up to this geyser that the game stomps me at to say it needs additional lava flow to blow. I keep moving further down to find the lava fall and Horus on a higher up ledge. He shouts me to get over to him so he can show me something. I fail my first attempt at jumping across the platforms in the lava and burn up. Luckily being incinerated with no trace remaining only does a point of damage. I jump across to the other side to Horus to point out that he's too high up for me. This leads him to the conclusion that Sphinx is holding him back. Why are all anthropomorphic birds in video games arrogant assholes? It goes on alone and leaves me, in time for a large worm thing to rise from some of the lava a little back. I go to it and step on its tongue, making it swallow me and spit me out. He's hungry, but not enough to eat Sphinx. He wants a coconut, which grew on the nearby trees. I fumble around a lot, not knowing how to get them down until I accidentally pass a rock that the game tells me I can pick up. So I throw them at the trees to knock them down. Once I've picked up all three coconuts in the area, I hand them over. In exchange, I can get on his tongue to make him spit me in the direction I want him to. So I get in his mouth and have him spit me onto the cliff Horus was talking down to me from. Turns out in all that time, he only took about 5 steps into the cave. He's found the blood of Ra, which will allow me to walk on lava, but he can't get to it thanks to all the exploding flowers around it. I pick up a nearby rock and blow them up with it. Flowers destroyed with rocks don't grow back. My main weakness here is muscle memory. The button used to pick up the rocks only drops them, not throws them. Since this is so similar to a Zelda game, I keep running forward and pressing the pickup button like in those, only to just gently place the rock on the ground. As soon as I destroy them all, Horus walks by and comes out with some excuses as to why he didn't think of a solution first. He uses the blood of Ra and goes off on his own again. I use the blood myself for a temporary shield and can now run on the lava flow all those platforms are coming from. At the end is a statue I can grab and pull away from this trench to divert the lava flow to get this geyser going. I go back to get the blood of Ra again and run over to said geyser to be launched higher up. I take a couple more geysers up to the top of this cave entrance. In front of it is this mechanical eyeball thing that sees me and then closes off the entrance. I drop down and hang on to this rail off the edge of the cliff. As soon as I'm out of its view, it opens up the entrance. I climb back up when it's looking away and run inside. In there is another one that closes me off from going in deeper. Throwing a rock at it will stun it for a bit, letting me move on. I end up outside again for that smug bird prick to shout me over to this cave entrance higher up. He tells me to throw a rock at this animal warren. Nearby is a huge boulder tied up still with ropes. I do as Horus says and a slim burble reveals itself. These become explosive when angered. They'll glow red and lunge in your direction. I lead them to all these ropes to make them explode on them. Removing them all makes the boulder roll towards the lava flow, giving me something I can use to cross and reach my first sacred statue, which allows me to save the game. Next to said statue I can climb this wall, dodging the spiders on the way to reach the spot where Horus was, who's run off ahead again. I dodge a couple eye lasers on the walls and then Horus explains climbing along a rail to me. There's a couple eyes to avoid here as well. After that I'm running along this cave until I'm back outside. Jump across a couple platforms and climb a rope to finally catch up with Horus again. He can see the blade of Osiris over on a rock pinnacle, but he can't see a way to reach it. There's a cave nearby with one of those statues I can pull to create a lava flow that makes two platforms rise from a hole near the pinnacle. Horus thanks Sphinx for his efforts and makes a run for the blade, but when he reaches the second bridge, the ray from the castle starts charging. It destroys the bridge, dropping Horus into the lava below, but he's saved by a passing rock. But thankfully that rock takes him over a lava fall, so I never have to deal with him again. Other games should kill their arrogant asshole birds off in the first 20 minutes. I cross the bridge, but since the second bridge is gone now, I have to go to the left and take this zipline across. Race just a straightforward walk to those platforms and I can get up to the blade of Osiris. Now I finally have a way to fight. Imhotep projects himself to Sphinx, telling him that taking the sword has alerted those in the castle of Uruk. He tells me that in the caves before the first bridge is a magical portal that was once used by the gods. Years earlier, he hid a portal amulet on a ledge on the portal chamber's exterior. Getting it will let Sphinx return to Inhotep's temple. I dropped down and ran over to the statue with a laser gate behind it, smashing the statue to get rid of the lasers. They were guarding more Blood of Ra, which lets me get back to the other side and go through that cave. Now I can just whack those eyeball things and keep moving. I leave this cave and enter another where a gate shuts behind me. I open the chest in here for a mysterious amulet. This can also be used at the portal. Grabbing it also opens these cages, releasing the spiders inside. One manages to grab my head, but they only take a few hits to kill. Getting rid of them opens the gate forward. I whack the lantern on the ceiling here for a single gold scarab. These are the game's main currency. What follows is a ridiculous backtrack to whack all the lanterns I can get to at the moment. About 5 minutes for an extra 3 scarabs. Let's skip that. I leave the cave on the other side to find this Eye of Ra post that is heavily worn. So I lure a slim burble over to it and make it explode to create a bridge. Hitting these trees on the other side for another scarab also makes this snake drop down, but it doesn't get to do anything before I kill it. Then at the entrance to the next cave is this weird skeletal thing that also doesn't get to try much. In the cave I'm blocked by an eyeball thing and its gears. These are called Set's Eyes, by the way. I swing over the gates on this rope and take out the mummy sandworm thing on the other side. Then I can just follow the cave until I'm outside again. There's a series of platforms to jump across, with lava bubbles also jumping up through the gaps to hinder me. They're not too much trouble though, and I reach this tower. There are 4 targets for me to jump attack, to really make sure I've got the concept of pressing jump and then attack. Hitting all 4 creates a platform that rises to a higher level. I smash another statue to create a bridge to the portal chamber's exterior. I head over to where Imhotep hid the portal amulet, but the ray from the castle charges again and blasts Sphinx inside. Imhotep shows up to rub in that I'm stuck in here with the wrong amulet. The only remaining choice is to use the mysterious amulet instead, despite not knowing where it would send him. I stand in a circle and offer the mysterious amulet to the portal god. It teleports Sphinx and the game fades out. We then fade in on a new guy, Prince Tutankhamun, being awoken on his birthday by a servant. Everyone in the castle is busy preparing for his birthday ceremony. She also says that Lady Nefertiti is waiting for him in the courtyard. So this is actually the first thing I saw of this game as a kid, and until finally playing this whole thing by myself, I'd always thought that Tut and Sphinx were the same person, just after a change of clothes. I thought this moment was how the game started, and the entire outskirts of Uruk section was completely new to me. Tut's big unique thing is his ability to crawl. Running around his bedroom, I bump into his flower pot and break it, upsetting the servant. I change Tut out of his pyjamas and open this wardrobe to find an old amulet. The other wardrobe here is locked. I then get told I can push and pull this table. I knock over another flower pot and get told I can move these statues too. The one on the left has another old amulet behind it. I break the last 2 flower pots to really upset the servant and swap these clothes out for a blue version. One wardrobe here has a huge lock on it and the last one has the courtyard key inside. That's all I can do in here, so I go through the door to the courtyard. I get to see an advisor talking to Nefertiti and learn that Tut has already asked her to marry him. But said advisor thinks that's a bad idea and tries to push her towards her brother, Akhenaten, before walking off, leaving some paper on the floor. Nefertiti goes to grab it, only for the wind to blow it up to a higher floor. I don't actually start off in the courtyard proper though, but in this hallway. Here I can talk to the prince's aunt. She's been collecting old amulets lately under orders from Akhenaten, who wants to store them in the treasure room. I give her the ones I already have, but there are still 6 left. Behind her, I pull out this statue to open a small hole in the wall. His aunt says it's one of the many old secret corridors hidden around the castle. This one's been blocked off though. I go to the opposite corridor from where I entered, only for a guard to block me from the door and tell me to go find Nefertiti in the courtyard. So I unlock the door opposite from the secret corridor. I run into the advisor on the way to the door to the courtyard and go through it. I first smash the flower pot because why not, and go talk to Nefertiti. She tells me about that letter that got blown away and wants me to get it for her. So I climb the ladder and find I'm gated off from the rest of the floor. But I can't sneak along the edges in front of the fences though. I reach the other side and run for that bird with the letter, but it flies off. I push this plinth that used to hold a flower pot and jump over the gate. I keep chasing the bird until it drops down near Nefertiti and then drops a letter for me to pick up. I hand it over to her. She wants to talk about the letter, but someone might be listening, so she wants to meet up outside the palace later. She says there are things he needs to know and that he should be careful. With business in the courtyard done, I go back inside. The door I was being blocked off from before, I can now enter. In this next room I meet Akhenaten. He's a bit of a dick, and also sounds resentful that no one goes through to the same efforts for his birthdays. The door directly across from where I entered is locked, so I go up the stairs instead and talk to this servant. She says that Akhenaten has been having them decorate the palace with these sarcophagi for some reason. I go through the door next to her into the dining hall. The second wardrobe on the right has my third old amulet inside it. I then jump on the table and start smashing shit while a servant begs me to stop. I don't. In the back left corner I can pull out a statue with her fourth old amulet. Pulling the one in the right corner removes this grate, blocking a tunnel behind the throne. I move the throne and crawl inside while the guy nearby tells me it isn't safe. In this dungeon, I run to the other side and crawl under a fence to pull a lever that opens a gate. Through that gate, I pull another lever that rotates the wall. In this new room, we overhear the advisor, Menes, telling Akhenaten that he believes Nefertiti has a letter. This prompts Akhenaten to decide they need to speed up their plans involving the sarcophagi. Menes will leave a spare sarcophagus key here in case they need one. The two then laugh over the unexpected birthday surprise they have planned for Tutankhamun. Right after they leave, I pull out this nearby statue for my fifth old amulet and then I take the sarcophagus key. The door here is locked from the other side, so I go back the way I came. I get an earful from the old guy when I return, but don't pay him any attention. There's a sarcophagus in the dining hall, so I use the key to get inside. I end up coming out of another, high up above the throne. I jump across to the right side of the room and get in the sarcophagus there to warp to the point higher up and just right at the room's entrance. I can then climb across to this chest containing my sixth old amulet, just two left. I have no health to worry about, so I just let myself fall from that height. I next drive the left side of the room and climb along to another sarcophagus. This one takes me to another secret tunnel. In the here's a chest with my sevenfold amulet. Then I just push this statue in the middle to fall down into a hole leading to the other tunnel. I leave the dining hall and go into the first sarcophagus I saw, without the cleaner even questioning it. This puts me back in the tunnel, but lets me grab this chest I couldn't get otherwise, containing the wardrobe key. With this, I can go through the door here to exit back into Tut's bedroom through one of the locked wardrobes. I use the key to unlock the other and then go inside. In here, I pull a lever to rotate the wall to another section. I climb this ladder, sneak along a pillar, and drop down to a chest containing the final old amulet. From there, I climb across some more pillars to reach the exit. It leads me back to the room outside the dining hall. I go back to Aunt Setit and give her the amulets. She asks me to leave them in the treasure room because she's too tired from standing still doing fuck all while I look for them to go do it herself. She gives me the treasure room key. It unlocks the door down the stairs below the dining hall. Inside, it's a mess. Someone's managed to break in and empty the place, the only thing remaining being a sarcophagus. Despite the old guy telling me not to go near it, I get in it anyway. Akhenaten and Menes have an army ready to invade the castle using all the sarcophagi they've had installed. Just in time for Tut to walk in and get captured. It fades out and we return to Sphinx to see where he ended up. I run opposite from the portal, breaking some vases for scarabs on the way and go through the door. We then see Tut tied to a table while Menes performs a ritual. Nefertiti is forced to watch while crying. A beam hits him and transfers his spirit into these floating vases, but back to Sphinx. Going forward there's a huge pit and two posts with empty slots on the other side. So I go up this ladder, I take a swinging rope to the other side and pull this lever to start moving platforms, raise a platform on one side and lower one on another. I did it too early though, so I pull it again to pull them back, pick up this skeleton in a cage and place it on the right platform. I then lower the lever again to lift it up and place it here so I can grab onto a ledge and reach a higher section. Hitting all three lanterns here opens up the wall and leads to a statue that I break for a glyph key. I throw the cage onto the platform on the left side and pull the lever again to lift it. I repeat the process on that side to gain a second glyph key. I place them both in those slots to get another rope moving that I ride over the pit to the other side. Here are four differently coloured buttons that I have to press in the right order. It's trial and error. The game makes a sound when I press the right button and a different one when it's wrong. Or I could just press a centre button to show the correct order, as I find out. The correct order ends up being red, blue, green, yellow, green, red. This lets me destroy the gate to the next room. In here are four targets. I can hit the first two, but the others are too high up. But pulling on this rope drops another cage I can stand on to reach them. Hitting all four targets removes this barrier and lowers some ropes in the previous room. I can't move forward thanks to rows of spikes, so I turn back. I climb up the rope left from the entrance and climb along the ledge past some spikes to a switch that removes one row of spikes. I do the same on the left side to get rid of the other. I cross those spikes and keep moving into another cutscene. The ritual has reduced Tutankhamun to a mummified corpse. Before the final touches can be performed, Menes centers Sphinx's presence. Akhenaten demands he be destroyed before he can interrupt the ceremony, so Menes starts another spell. Back with Sphinx, I get attacked by the skeleton with a scythe. He doesn't get to try much before a few hits deal with it. The other one I get to work on before it can even finish animating. I just do a lap around this room, taking out the rest of the skeletons that attack me. Destroying them all creates a bridge to the centre of the room. I open up the door here to obtain the Shield of Osiris. If equipped, it does what you would expect a shield to do. You can also aim it. I've now hit a dead end, so I backtrack all the way to the portal room. To the left of the portal is a door guarded by a laser beam that destroys you if you get close. I have to block the ray and then when it stops to recharge, run right through. In here I can hear Menes chanting. I run around and find a rope to cut. This drops a gigantic amulet being used for the ritual, cutting it off early. Akhenaten demands Menes turns it off before it explodes, but seconds later it starts sucking them in. Not just them, those vases we saw earlier get dragged in, along with Tut's corpse. Then it explodes. The remaining energy reanimates the three followers of Akhenaten who all move on Nefertiti before Sphinx intervenes. They've got flaming sticks and take less hits to kill than the skeletons did. Seeing Nefertiti crying over her boyfriend's death, Sphinx rocks up with the smuggest expression on his face. The vase with part of his soul inside is all that remains of him. She lets Sphinx have it in the hope that he may be able to use it and bring him back. After Sphinx takes the canopic vase, she also gives him an amulet Tut once gave her. Imhotep projects himself, saying Sphinx needs to meet him in Heliopolis as soon as possible, since the whole situation just rubs him the wrong way and they need to find the source of the enemy's power before it gets too strong. He says that the portal amulet Nefertiti gave him can get him out of the palace. Meanwhile, he will help Nefertiti escape from the palace and from the game itself. We will not see her again after this scene. Finally, he gives me a gold Ankh. These are the heart containers of the game, increasing my maximum health by 1 Ankh. I return to the portal and use the Abydos amulet I was given to walk to Abydos. For some reason, they built their portal in a sewer. There's a fenced off section I can't do anything with just yet, all I can do is leap through the door. I climb up the ladder next to the door and chat to this bird guy. I get to learn that the water surrounding Abydos is electrified. The city was doing extremely well until the electric eels arrived. I enter this square and throw off this juggler's concentration out of spite. To the right from where I entered is a guy who lost his wife's pearl necklace and the replacement he bought is missing 3 pearls. So if I find any Abydosian pearls, I should bring them to him. To the left still is this rail going around the outside of the city walls. I drop down and keep following the wall to find a vase I can smash containing the first pearl. There's also a rail I can grab to the right of the guy. It has a second pearl in a jar. Back into the center, I jump down the well. It puts me on the other side of that fence in the sewer. Swimming to the bottom of the water I land in gets me an old key, and climbing this ladder gets me the last Abydosian pearl and another vase. The key is used for unlocking the gate so I can leave. I give the man the pearls and in return I get the key that opens the door to the upper walkway. First I go through the door a little to the right of him. This is the Corridor of Champions, where a crocodile man can challenge me to a few gauntlets. But before I can try one, I have to pass a test. I have to return that diamond behind the fence to him in less than 20 seconds. The problem is I simply cannot do it right now. The fence is too high up, I can't jump over it, and there's nothing to stand on for a boost, so I fail. Back outside, in this corner is a vase that drops green scarabs when destroyed. These are worth 5 gold scarabs each. Near this vase is another building I can enter. This is a museum. On the left, a guard blocks off the Hall of Jewels for not being ready yet, so I just give up, ignore everything else he said, and leave. I go unlock the door with that key so I can reach the upper walkway. I follow the path around and enter the first door I find. This is Montu's Monster Shop. I can buy or sell monsters here. I can't catch monsters yet, so all I can do is buy, and I can't even afford the cheapest one right now. But the cheapest is 70 scarabs, and I'm 10 off, so I go back outside the museum to get them. I can then enter and leave the museum to farm 10 scarabs at a time. I first buy the small frog for 70 scarabs, and the rat for 100 scarabs. Then it's back to farming. My next purchase is a shell critter for 360 scarabs. I decide to leave the grind for now and move further into the city. Taking a right turn takes me to this beggar. I give him 10 of my 20 remaining scarabs for now and go into the building next to him. The guy inside says I can't play the game there until I have a blowpipe. Moving further on is another one I can enter. In here is a mystical sequence game costing 5 scarabs per attempt. This is pretty much just the one I did earlier in Luxor Dungeon. Same 4 colours, just have to press them in the right order. Getting them all right awards me double the money I paid and allows me to play an intermediate game for 10 scarabs. It's the same, but harder. Once again I win double what I paid and can now play the expert game for 20 scarabs. Once again, it's even harder. This time I win 45 scarabs, 5 more than double the amount I paid. It also awards me the Medal of Sequences. Right now it does nothing, but I'll have a use for it later. I then go straight back to farming scarabs. After about 15 minutes I have the 300 scarabs to buy a mummy bird. That's the last of these monsters I can buy for now, as the rest cost more than my current 400 scarab cap. Now it's time to check out the rest of the museum, finally. Heading straight forward from the entrance takes me to another room, where the Mayor of Abydos is opening the first hall of the museum. While he's talking up all the history it will showcase, we see someone whispering to one of the mayor's sketchy underlings, who tells him they have to cut the ceremony short. Their jewel collection has been stolen a few minutes ago. All this bad stuff happening to the city is taking its toll on the mayor. The only thing that remains in the collection is a sarcophagus, which confuses the mayor because there wasn't one in the collection. So he and his staff leave for their council chambers to discuss it further. The bird guy on the left tells me they'll reward anyone who can return any of the stolen jewels. But right now it's the guy on the right I'm wanting. He wants to complete a wildlife exhibit of all animals in the world. This is what I was buying those monsters for. The rooms around here already have a few animals I'm not capable of capturing already on display, such as the electric eels that are surrounding the city. I start by handing over the mummy bird. As a reward for donating my first animal, I'm given a zipline handle. I can now ride down any zipline around the city just by jumping into it. I then donate the rat, shell critter, and small frog before I get going again. Past the beggar, I cross this bridge and at the other end find I can't go any further without identification. In the middle of the bridge I can zipline down to this boat. It's owned by Khonsu, who will give me a ride to Heliopolis for 25 scarabs. I don't go just yet. On the opposite side I can zipline to another bridge and drop down to a door I can't enter right now. I return to the beggar and give him 20 more scarabs. For 30 total he gives me a gold Ankh piece. These are like the heart pieces in Zelda, 4 of them to make a hole. Near the square on the upper walkway is a zipline taking me to a vase with a red scarab inside. These are worth 10. At this point I finally take the boat ride to Heliopolis. Meanwhile, we finally get to see what happened to the others. Akhenaten, Menes, and Tutankhamun's corpse were teleported to the castle of Uruk. Without Tut's life energy, he's useless to them, so they have his corpse thrown in jail. Losing their warping amulets has also slowed down their plans. It's at this point we learn that Akhenaten is an imposter using his shape. He'll explain that Tut died in an accident and gained power in Luxor. He reveals his true shape and says that he also knows Sphinx is a student of Imhotep. No one knows he's even involved in this, which he believes he can use to throw off Sphinx and Imhotep. After that scene, I arrive at Heliopolis. Once a great kingdom, now a wasteland. Khonsu thinks I was safer in Abydos and sets off back there immediately. To the left is a temple with a worn down dogman outside. He says Heliopolis was great until the god Anubis got involved. He cursed his brother and everyone else in the cursed palace. He also planted Eye of Ra posts around the desert, along with making the soil infertile. While he complains, the camera moves to show me Anubis' temple. Nearby is a little pedestal with an image of the bird that I can't do anything with yet. On my way to the temple is a zipline that's too high up for me to reach with a jump. There's also these big skull rock things I can't do anything with yet. I go through the temple entrance and oh fucking hell, why aren't you dead? He thinks the Blade of Osiris should be his because if he had a better sense of self-preservation, he'd have grabbed it first. Well, tough. He also thinks I'm not good enough because I can't jump up to the level he's on. He says Imhotep is waiting for me in the temple on Sunshrine Island. While I go to him, he brags about how he'll solve the Anubis problem. While I smash these vases, a fiery skeleton thing lunges at me on fire. I lure it over to this wooden box to burn it away and grab the eagle stone inside. I could now summon a great eagle when standing on those pedestals, so I return to the one earlier and use it. I get picked up by the eagle and it carries me over the post and drops me on this cliff. I climb a rope higher up and see a huge boulder held on a wooden platform. Running past it to the top of this hill takes me to a tower with a sign written in a language I can't understand. There's another pedestal between the boulder and tower that I used to get carried over to the western side of this area. The sign here points me in the direction of South Beach and Sunshrine Island, but some rocks are blocking the path. Nearby is a hole that spawns slim burbles. I lead one up to the rocks to destroy them and go through to South Beach. There's a dog guy here who will challenge me to a swimming course. I just have to swim through all his checkpoints. It's pretty simple, even if some are a bit sneaky by having the next checkpoint spawn off screen, risking me wasting time looking for it. When I finish, I'm told I finished it in under 71 seconds and won a prize. He gives me the crocodile scales that allow me to swim faster underwater. To the left of the swimmer is a tent with a vase inside that I can smash for an Atunai. Remember those skull things in the previous area? I can use it with those. There's a couple in here who don't care about me breaking their ship. Sunshrine Island is this one with a Sphinx not the character on it. The crocodile scales really make swimming to it much, much faster. Once I reach it, I go inside. Imhotep is meditating, waiting for me. He's glad to see I also grabbed the Shield of Osiris while I was in Uruk. He's very interested in the Canopic Vase I brought back. It's been a while for him, but he may be able to release the soul trapped inside. Imhotep consents to Tutankhamun in the castle of Uruk. If he can be revived, it will be a big help, since no one has managed to get inside before. However, no living thing can get through the castle's protection to reach him, so he enchants a nearby basket to come to life. Fade out to the castle of Uruk. We see Tut's corpse in jail with many other remains. The basket, simply known as Basket and looking very much like a rare character, approaches the corpse. He uses the Canopic Vase to transfer the piece of Tut's soul into his body. He comes to life and Basket explains what's going on. He says that Tut's only hope is to help them out so they can understand the significance of the castle and who's behind it all. He has to explore the castle, looking for any clues or objects that would help Sphinx out in making him human again. Basket then fades out, leaving him to it. All I can do here is jump on this hanging cage and then to a ladder out of the room. One benefit to Tut being dead is that he can't take damage and thus can't die again. I jump from cage to rail to another cage to another rail to one last cage to a door. This next room contains the ray that utterly failed at killing Horus. There's also these moving metal rods with spiked balls on the end that I can jump between and ride up out of this hole into the area Akhenaten and Menes were speaking last time we saw them. Speaking of Menes, he's telling the guards to make sure that all the traps are working so no one can get in the castle. He leads through this door which is guarded by a set sign that shuts the doors when it spots me. There's also this one on the opposite side that does the same. Each door that can be shut has a nearby switch that opens it again. It's that second door opposite the first that I need to enter, as the set side guarding the first is too quick to sneak past. The door shuts behind me and the camera spans to show the area I have to work out the puzzle to. Where I start, there are two cages and a turned off electrical device. In the water on the left is a set of bars keeping me from a chest. In the middle of the water is another item barred off from me. This leaves just a door on the right which leads to a chest. As I go to open it, it falls through the floor to be replaced by a giant spiked electric ball. It shocks Tut and electrifies him. The nearby sarcophagus advises him to use electricity to his advantage. However, I lose it when I make contact with water. To not touch water, I drag these platforms on the floor to make a path back to the main area. I then touch the ball again and jump across the platform so I can touch the device from before and power it. This makes the first door and Abydos jewel appear in the centre. The floor in the middle then closes around me and catapults me into a door higher up. The door opens and lets me in, allowing me to alert a set side that opens and closes the floor behind it repeatedly. I choose to drop through the floor when I see a chest. But before I can do anything, the walls close in and crush me, completely flattening me. It also turns out that the chest was a trap, since it disappears whenever you get close. I head backwards and through the door. Being flattened allows me to walk through bars like these. I backtrack to where I dropped from and cross the floor, using the grooves in the wall to keep myself from falling. It leads to another door that locks behind me. I can grab onto this in front of the door, but it doesn't do anything for me right now. I drop down to the right and enter this room that electrifies me, and then jump across these platforms to activate them and make them rise. I can jump off the third, go through this corridor, and desperately avoid the water as I jump for the next platform. This also turns on the spinning platforms in front of me. These take me to another device to activate. It does nothing right now though, so I return to get electrified and take on the left side of the room. The layout is almost the same, but with a second spinning platform instead of the rising water. Turning on both devices has the rail moving, so I grab it and ride it to the other end where I can open this chest for the Lunar Planetarium key. The game tells me it looks similar to the shrine in the central hall. Grabbing it unlocks the door and lets me leave. I return to the central hall and while flat, go through the bars to the chest on the left side of the room. The chest contains the exit key. Behind it is a lever that opens the gate blocking me from this item. Said item is the Solar Planetarium key. Taking it shuts down the cannon. I put the Lunar key in its place and it activates again. However, it shoots me to a different section. Through this door I set off another set side that gets the platforms behind it moving. It also sets off three lasers I have to avoid on those platforms by either jumping or crouching. But I hit the red one which sets me on fire. This is useful. First I burn away this wooden fence blocking my progress. Next is these wooden cages that have been lying around. They contain onyx scarabs, which can only be used in a certain place. Backtracking and getting all the scarabs I've been walking past gets me a total of 70 onyx scarabs. I return to where I burn that fence and go through the door. I jump off this platform without being able to see where I'm going and narrowly avoid water. This is good because there's more onyx scarabs to burn out near me. I jump onto this thing behind the cage and my fire extends a bridge from the entrance. To the left of that one is a lever that makes a platform rise back up to the entrance with water. On the right side I move more platforms to make a path to another wooden fence. I return on fire and burn through the fence to another lever. This one rotates a central tower to make other sections available. Taking my new path on the bottom, there's another of those cage things powered by fire. But the platform that gets me to it is below water. The solution is these statues in the back. Pulling the right one makes that platform rise, and pulling the left one makes one on that side rise. I get in the cage on the right to extend a bridge above it. I pull the previous lever again to put the tower back to how it was, so I can get in the cage there too for another bridge above that. I use the lever again and this time get on the tower from the upper section. I jump onto the bridge and get to the right side. I sneak across the wall, avoiding the spikes, and jump back across to the tower to find the opposite side was hiding a chest. This one gives me the Earth Planetarium key. That's all for here, as both sides on the upper level lead to the same place. I return to the area with the first electrifying ball and gain the sarcophagus. There's a fence behind it that I can't reach without electricity going off at least once, so hiding helps me avoid it and stay on fire. I burn the fence and pull the lever to lower the fence, blocking the exit. I then swap the Lunar key for the Earth key. This time the cannon shoots me to the exit and I can use the key. Behind it is a chest with the wings of Ibis inside. By the way, Toad is far more expressive and compelling dead than he was alive. He turns and struts away, but his life force runs out and he drops dead and returns to jail. Basket returns to Sphinx and Imhotep and hands over the stolen jewel and wings of Ibis. Imhotep tells me to keep Basket and lets me know that if I had the Book of the Dead, I could send him back to Tut whenever I find another Canopic vase. Imhotep believes the book is in the Cursed Palace, so I should go speak to Anubis about it. The wings of Ibis allow me to do a double jump, the jumping off of their kind, not the Mario kind. I also got those onyx scarabs too. When I leave and swim back to the beach, I place my one Atuan eye into this eye socket near the tent. Khonsu is on the beach and I have him send me back to Abydos. First thing I do is return to the museum and hand in that stolen jewel, the Jewel of Shu. As thanks, I'm giving a gold ankh piece. Next I return to the Corridor of Champions. Now I can double jump, I can easily grab the diamond and bring it back in less than half the time limit. I can now play the gauntlet for 10 scarabs. I have to dodge the moving walls, smash all the statues and reach the end within the time limit. I have 100 seconds and this one is very easy. The walls are thin and just require simply moving towards the holes, sometimes jumping. The statues are all low down and just require jumping to reach and there's two on each side. I manage it on my first try with just over 48 seconds remaining. For my time, I'm awarded 30 scarabs. Completing that lets me try Gauntlet 2. This time the first two statues are higher up and we have some more complex walls. I also have 200 seconds for this one. The key to the higher statues are these large walls with staircases. I climb up and wait for it to take me to the groove for the statue. That one statue did take a quarter of my time though. I get the other one on the left easy enough, and then wait for the first staircase where the stairs start on the left, so I can jump to the third statue. With the third one down, I still have just 100 seconds for the last one, which can be got from the ground easy enough. After that, I run to the end and finish with 68 seconds remaining. I win another 30 scarabs. Not done yet though, I now have Gauntlet 3. This one is the hardest. The statues are at all the same heights as Gauntlet 2, but now there's a bigger variety of more complex obstacles. I now have 300 seconds. Simple walls are gone and now replaced with things like corridors I have to run through while I'm being dragged towards the back. The first time, I fail when I get dragged into the pit in the back. This one takes me quite a few attempts. The main issue is waiting for a set of stairs high enough to reach the first two statues with. Add to that, even after getting them, a lot of these moving rooms are good time wasters, dragging you back quite a distance if you get one of the more annoying ones. Not to mention when you think you can just get to the lower statues or the exit, but one of them just pushes you out of the way at the last second, making you waste time finding the entrance and then the time it takes to get through. Double jumping is helpful too, as you're not on the floor being dragged back. I managed to finish this one with 37 seconds remaining. The price of clearing all three gauntlets is the Medal of Champions. With that done, I have Khonsu ride me back to Heliopolis. Outside Anubis' temple, there's a zipline I need of a double jump to use. It takes me to a switch requiring the slam by pressing attack after a double jump. It creates a bridge to a part of the game I definitely do remember as a kid, because this obstacle course this guy challenges me to, my grandmother could never complete in time, so she'd have me try it, and it still took me a while back then. The only rule of this course is that I fail if I fall into water. It starts with a boring climb up a ladder, then jump into a rope and climbing to the top, zip line down to another platform, ride the rail across very slowly while nothing happens and you lose time, let go too early and fall into water. Next time, drop on the platform, slam the switch, and thanks to camera placement, not realise the platform behind me moving up until it's too late and I lose time waiting for it to come back down. Then not see where I'm supposed to jump to, give up, and jump in the water. Next time, jump onto a boardwalk, swing across to another, climb a rope to the top, and ride the final zipline down to the finish. My first success is a time of 81 seconds. It's quite hard to cut down time. It's just a case of jumping quicker and not turning as wide while running. It takes me nearly 10 more minutes to knock 3 seconds off my first time, getting 78 and breaking the record. He gives me a gold ankh piece. Well, 10 to 15 minutes is a lot quicker than the hour or so I remember it taking me when I was 11. Now it's time to finally reach that platform at the Temple of Anubis. I slam the switch to open the door and head inside. In this first room I have to fight 3 of these imp things that like to fly and kick me a lot. They move quickly too, so it's a pain to catch them with my sword. They also shrink when you do hit them. I get lucky and kill 2 with the same attack and the last one goes down soon after. This opens the door into the huge main central room. I cross the bridge into the fiery skeleton rat spawn. I start by leading them up the bridge to these cages to burn them. It's only money, but they're all permanently destructible items, so I've got to get them all. One of the 3 does contain a required glyph key too. I cross the bridge again and try to insert it, but the game doesn't pause in these menus, allowing the enemies to beat me down and kill me. When was the last time I saved? Before trying the gauntlets, so I have to do all 3 of those again and the obstacle course record. One change is that I put my 1 out of 9 in this skull near the cursed palace. 20 minutes later, I'm back and I can finally put that key in. It activates a lift to the next level. I also save here, making absolutely sure I don't have to repeat all that again. There's this big green statue I can pick up, but for now I cross this bridge and it's another colour sequence game. Getting it right makes this door glow and I can smash it. It leads to a chest containing the blowpipe. Continuing the Zelda comparisons, this is the bow, but it has infinite ammo. I also pull the lever in here to extend a bridge at the other end of this room. I'll even use the blowpipe to shoot these 2 targets on either end of the room. Both of them activate a moving platform and bring it to this end. I grab that statue and carry it to the left one. Apparently supposed to throw them on, but I got lucky and landed on it when I ran off the edge. I then shoot the target again to bring the platform back to that side. I throw the statue over and deal with these enemies. They're a bit like the ones I fought in the first room, but less aggressive and easier in every way. I drop the statue on a switch to unlock the door here. There's some wooden fences I can't deal with yet and a cyclops with eye lasers that splits in 2 when I hit it. Each of the 2 just take a single extra hit to kill. Race up the stairs and pulling a lever to extend that bridge even further. Next step is to grab that statue and use the targets to bring it to the other side of the room. This side has bipedal cats that attack with their claws. This one gets stuck on a pillar which makes it easier to kill. Then he's putting the statue on this switch to unlock the door. I run right in and drop into some flamethrowers. I have to grab the mesh above and climb across to another lever gathered by a skeleton spider crab scorpion that takes a couple hits to kill. This lever extends the bridge to its furthest point. I can now jump to it from the central area. Here I get attacked by a goat man with a pickaxe. The only way to damage him is to get around him when he attacks and hit his unarmored back. Even then, he still takes a few hits. Once he's dead, I can finally go through this door. Sphinx walks up to the statue of Anubis, which begins to speak to him. He's not impressed. Sphinx has to prove his worthiness if he wants to free the people in the cursed palace. First, he has to walk closer on an invisible bridge over a lava pit. Second task is to capture 3 fire armadillos in the previous room. That's the things that killed me. To do this, Anubis gives me one of the most important items in the game, the capture beetles. This is what I'll be mainly using for the animal collection for the museum. To capture an enemy, I have to weaken an enemy to the point they flash yellow and then lead the beetle into them. Fire armadillos infinitely spawn here, so I get to work. I get the 3 and go back to Anubis. This finally impresses him, as Horus tried this earlier and failed. Get fucked, Horus. Anubis grants me 2 curse stones to free any 2 prisoners in the cursed palace that I choose. He also lets me know that I can release captured fire armadillos and slim burbles to use their skills. So while I'm trying to capture one of every enemy, I'll always be stocking up on multiple of those 2. I start by using fire armadillos to burn all these cages in the previous room that I couldn't before. I also make sure to burn those wooden fences. The vases behind them just have more scarabs and beetle refills. Once I've burned all the wood, I leave. Outside, confirmed useless piece of shit Horus is waiting for me. Suddenly he says he was wrong about me and admits I'm superior to him without using those exact words. As a token of goodwill, he gives me a dark stone of invisibility. He apologises for being a waste of space and runs off. But before I can use it, Imhotep interrupts and says it's a trap. Horus was a salty bitch all along, and using the stone also causes instant death. Imhotep does say that Tuk could make use of it though, so I store it away in Basket, ready for the next time I grab a canopic vase. Imhotep muses that him surviving falling into lava may have been more than just good luck. First thing is burning up these cages in front of the temple entrance. I can stock up on more armadillos from that hole below. Next to the obstacle course are 3 targets each on a small island. I have to shoot them all in quick succession. The timing is strict and getting the aiming right for all 3 at such varied differences is difficult, so it takes me a few minutes. When I finally shoot them all in time, it spawns a chest. Inside is another gold ankh piece. That's my 4th, so I can increase my health, but there's an extra step I'm not aware of yet. Next I return to Abydos. Now I have the blowpipe, I can go to the house next to the beggar and play the minigame. I have to shoot doors with the blowpipe and match 2. The aim is to match them all within 60 seconds. Of course, when it comes to these, the easy strategy is to always just shoot them in order and wait until you find a second of one you've already found. It works for me this time, but what makes me fail to hit the target is my slow aiming. Aiming can be a little sensitive, so I'm always nudging the cursor along to avoid moving it too far. A few attempts later and I finish it in 54 seconds, winning me the Medal of Memory. I then donate a fire armadillo to the museum before I return to Heliopolis. Using the Eagle Stone, I return to that boulder on a wooden platform and set the platform on fire. The boulder rolls down and destroys this huge pillar to reveal a chest hidden inside. It contains another gold ankh piece. Time to finally enter the cursed palace. Straight ahead there's 2 cursed guys in the back and 2 of those Cyclops enemies from before. I capture one, learning its name is actually just Cyclops. Killing them both unlocks the doors on either side. Make sure to burn this cage too. I take the right door and then choose to save the guy second on the right. He was summoned to Heliopolis from Abydos to write the Pharaoh's autobiography before he got caught in the curse. His experience has given him inspiration for a new book, so he's going back to Abydos to start on it. As thanks, he gives me the Book of the Dead. This is what allows me to send Basket to Tuk with the canopic vases. Next I go into the left room and free the guy on the right. He's the brother of the farmer outside. He lets me know that this place is actually the Pharaoh's palace before he leaves to find his brother. In one of the corners of this room, I break a vase to find an Atunai inside. Back in the other room, I find a blade scorpion in a vase. One hit is enough to let me capture it. When I leave, the farmers are waiting for me outside. They want to return to their farm, but the Eyes of Ra are keeping them away. First I grab myself some more fire armadillos and go back inside the cursed palace to burn down all those cages. One contains an Atunai. I also find a cobra in a vase that I killed last time. 2 hits to make it weak enough for capture. The other cage just has money in it. I fill the other eye socket of the skull nearest to the palace. Filling both eyes makes it disappear, leaving behind an Atun disc. Standing on one of these gives me a temporary speed boost, but first it's straight back to Abydos. The entire journey there was just to hand over my Blade Scorpion, Cobra and Cyclops to the museum. Then it's back to Heliopolis. Since I have a leftover Atun eye, I put it in the skull nearest to the Temple of Anubis. Rather than use the Atun discs, I have the eagle fly me to the other side. I stock up on a load of slim burbles. These are the easiest animal to capture since you don't have to hit them, just steer the beetle into them. I turn around and use one to blow up this Eye of Ra post. Then working my way south from the top of the farm, I blow up one more. I try to cross the bridge to the next, but it somehow sees behind itself and lasers me, spawning me back at the boat. I try the Atun disc next time, but it still doesn't let me outrun the lasers. Next time I just take the first eagle and then drop down the cliff behind them all. Working my way south, I destroy all 3 posts in the sand. That just leaves the second one on the farm that manages to hit me again. After many failed attempts, I think to send out the burble from the bridge, finally taking out the last post and making this area simple to move around in. Getting rid of that one also lets me burn these cages. One of them has an Atun eye. I then find another eye in a vase behind the farmer's tent. I stick one in the skull that used to be in the middle of the 3 Ra posts. The second completes the one outside the Temple of Anubis for another Atun disc. I go back to the farmers to let them know they can return to their farm. They tell me to visit them later so they can help me. Back to Abydos to donate a slim burble to the museum. Then the game freezes on the loading screen on the boat ride back. I didn't lose much though, just donating the slim burble, which I did again off camera. I go to the farmer's tent to see what they meant by help. While farming, they found a canopic vase, so I send it with Basket to Tut. Basket gives him his soul and hands him the Dark Stone of Invisibility. It only works when standing still. Once he moves, he'll become visible again. Once again, I leap through the ladder, go through the same room, and then climb out of the pit with the ray. This time, my target is the door opposite the one I took last time. Back then, I couldn't get through because it's more closed in than the other, and the set sign moves faster, which makes it impossible to get through in a single sprint. That's where the Dark Stone comes in. Turn invisible, inch forward when it turns away, and turn invisible again until I get through that door. And right away, in this new area, my first obstacle is another set of set eyes. Like in the last room, if they spot you, there's a switch by the entrance to open all the doors again. After sneaking through the first corridor, I get to see Akhenaten and Menes talk some more. Horus is a spy for them and has to report that Sphinx has made contact with Anubis. Menes says it doesn't matter since he blocked off Heliopolis Point with the Seal of Atun, so he can't get very far. Only the Atun statue used to create the seal can break it, so at least I know what I'm looking for this time. Horus thinks he's so smart giving Sphinx that stone, thinking he should be dead by now. He walks off screen with the others and we will never see him again. Shame, they gave me plot reason to kill him and then never have him appear again. I go up some nearby stairs and through a door. In here I run through another room and up this ramp. This triggers the blades above that to cut me into three. I can swap between all my cells using the shoulder buttons. I try lighting myself on fire for all these cages, but it runs out immediately. Instead I just run straight ahead, turn right and get crushed. I then take the left path into this lava room and jump across the platform so I can slip through the bars on the left and climb this ladder and get blown back down by fans. I run past them next time and stand on a switch that raises this block at the end. I then swap to Tut number 2. I have him continue down the right path to a room with a chest containing the second stolen Abydos jewel. This activates a furnace in that spot to set me on fire. Can't take the fire back to those cages though because the crusher puts it out. Instead I climb this ladder and sneak along the wall avoiding the spikes. The path it leads to lets me drop down past the crusher and I can finally burn all those cages, all two of them, for a total of 15 onyx scarabs. I return to the lava room and burn another cage for 15 more onyx scarabs. Since I'm on fire, I can walk through the lava fall on the right and climb another ladder. Get 15 more onyx scarabs from another cage and jump across the rising platforms above water. Run through another lava fall and get on another switch. This raises another block behind the first one. Now for Tut number 3. I bring into the blocks but he can't get on top. So I take the other two Tuts off their switches to lower them. I get Tut number 3 on the first one, lift him with Tut number 1 switch, move Tut number 3 to the second block, then lift him with Tut number 2 switch. I can now grab the chest containing the Atun statue. This is a shorter one for Tut and he drops dead again. Basket returns to Sphinx and hands over the Onyx Scarabs, the stolen jewel and the Atun statue. While running around on the western side of this area, I come down here and find another Atun eye in a chest, along with another cage to burn. Next I get in the water and go against the stream to this little waterfall with a pair of boulders behind it. A slim burble blows it up to reveal a chest, but it only took one out so it won't let me open it. While restocking my animals, I put the eye in the other socket of that skull, unlocking my third Atun disc. I blow up the other boulder and open that chest for a gold ankh piece. Back to Abydos next to return that stolen jewel, I'm given my seventh gold ankh piece. Back to Heliopolis and near the obstacle course, I go to the wall of the Temple of Anubis and burn a cage for another Atun eye. Right at the north of this area is a purple barrier. This is what Menes was talking about having put up earlier. There's a place for me to insert the Atun statue in front of it. The barrier goes and I can talk to this crying guy behind it. His wife Keta has gone missing. He thought he could hear a voice in this building, but he's too afraid to go in. He begs me to help out, so I go in. As soon as I enter, I get attacked by these asshole mummy chihuahuas. They like to jump on me and maul me. I make sure to capture one before they're all dead, but they end up leaving me with such little health. That's not the end of it though. A worm thing comes out of a smoky green thing in the middle of the floor. It grabs my head in its mouth and throws me. I must have been spat at by these guys I fought back in Uruk. I manage to slam the first enemy as it rises. A second hit and I can capture it, learning its name is the Green Giant Worm. Its death also creates a statue I can smash for another Atun eye. I jump up to deal with the others but get my last bit of health spat out of me. I last saved back in Abydos after handing over the jewel, so all I lost was those two Atun eyes that I get back with ease. This time I managed to capture the enemy. Now it's time for me to get climbing this place. Moving clockwise along the outside, which also takes me up, I run into this electrified creature. It jumps to cause a shockwave, but that makes it lose its electricity and gives me the chance to hit it. After two hits, I can capture a half brute. The asshole still manages to damage me even after I've captured it. Next part is jumping over extending and receding platforms. Burn a cage and get jumping across some ropes. The first vase after that contains another Atun eye. Next up, there's a slot for a glyph key that I don't have. Halfway between the ropes and this is another rope I can climb. It leads to a statue I can smash for the key. Put it in to make the platforms move and let me climb higher. Burn another cage for another rat and eye. I have 4 right now. I then go through the door to the next area. Left leads to a save statue, so if I die, I don't have to do all that again. Then running to the right, there's another slot for a glyph key and a lever hidden behind bars. So I cross this bridge, which involves climbing across the railing to avoid spikes. At the end, one of the enemies from Luxor Dungeon shows up to fight me again. I stun lock it with 5 normal slashes and capture myself a skull worshipper. Going to the left, I get fenced in and attacked by these guys with 2 swords. 5 slashes is once again enough to let me capture this sharp beak. There's also a new armadillo to deal with. This one is an electric armadillo and I capture it too. The next wave is another electric armadillo and a skeleton with a sword, the skull swordsman, who I also capture. Third wave is nothing new, a sharp beak and a half brute. But I get knocked off the bridge and when I fade back in, I'm already being killed by the shockwave. I once again capture everything again and clear that third wave on my second attempt. Something I don't always think is that I can always capture a duplicate of a non-item monster if it'll be more inconvenient than getting the last hits in normally. Wave 4 is another half brute and skull swordsman. Killing them lowers the gates and lets me reach a chest containing the glyph key. I take it back and put it in to lower the bars nearby. I pull the lever to unlock the door on the right past the bridge. But I'm absolutely saving first before trying anything else. Normally, I'm an obsessive saver, but for some reason it just keeps slipping my mind playing this game. I go through the door, deal with the 2 annoying cyclops, and start messing with these 4 levers. They're for extending the platforms higher up. The correct order to get them all out is, from the left, the first, third, then fourth. I then go out the door and ride this rope next to it to another door higher up. I go through this one and end up fighting another of the cat enemies. I capture it, finding its name is just Knives Cat. With that, I get to the platforms. Now this is what I remember this game for the most. You might find that confusing, it's a series of platforms with flamethrowers between them, nothing too out there. But when my grandmother was playing this back in 2003 or 2004, this took weeks. For some reason, whether it was a glitch or maybe some weird anti-piracy measure, the game would not allow her to make it across the second jump. Sphinx would just refuse to land on the platform and slide off. I gave it many tries myself and still wouldn't do it, so it wasn't just her. She explored every available location for something, thinking maybe she was missing some kind of item. But no. Until one day where out of nowhere, the game just let her cross. To this day, we still have no idea what that was about. When I brought up that I was playing this game for the show, a game she probably hadn't thought about in over 15 years, this moment was the first thing she brought up. Even my mum, who'd pretty much stopped playing games at this point, remembered her being stuck on this for so long. These platforms are fucking history in my family. I even slid down the first time in this playthrough and thought, oh no, for a moment. But that time it was actually my fault and I made it across with ease on the second attempt. The chest at the end has another glyph key. Open it, fences me in here and makes me fight 3 spike spiders. I make sure to capture one and kill the rest. On my way back I fall between the middle platforms and land on the area below. Down here there's a Karank firing point. These can be used to teleport between each other. If I stand on one and shoot the Karank with a blowpipe, I'll teleport close to it. But first, through the door behind is a chest with 100 gold scarabs inside. Shame my wallet was already full, but at least it didn't make me put them back and leave the chest unopened. Now I can use the Karank to teleport. I return to the platform to put the glyph key into a slot next to them to unlock the next door. In the next room, I get attacked by one of these purple guys from earlier. 5 hits let me capture the crab hands. At the opposite end from where I started from, there's a lever that drops a cage onto a moving platform. I have to wait for it to get close, jump on, throw the cage over the pit, and get going with it. I take it down this bridge. A crab claw sees me and runs for me, but as it passes through this gate, a spiked ceiling comes down on it. There are lasers on either side of this gate beaming into it. I plant the cage below the laser on the left and use it to whack it. I then do the same on the right, which turns off the spikes. Across another bridge and through the door. The door closes behind me and nearby is a barrier surrounding this little tower, with Keta trapped inside. I talk to her and she says that the 3 coloured beams entering the force field are what's powering it. Each beam leads to another room. First I start with the room on the left of the entrance. I shoot these 3 targets to make some platforms rise from the lava so I can cross and get inside. Right away at the entrance is a switch that lowers a cage in the middle of the area, but doesn't stay pressed when I get off it. Across from the entrance I climb a rope and jump onto this section with a blue light only for a green worm to throw me off right away. I decide to just ignore it and run past it. I follow this path around the outside and at one point blow up this boulder with a slim burble to create a minor shortcut. I follow the path some more to reach a red light. I lose way too much health to that worm. In fact, it kills me. By next time I figured out a safer way of fighting them. I run through a tunnel to the right of the entrance to reach an area with this tree spitting at me. Those attacks come fast and are hard to dodge. I jump over to it and accidentally kill it before I can capture it. I can now jump across to a Karank point and teleport across this large gap. around where it starts me is a yellow light. Also next to where it starts me is another car anchor point so I can teleport again. First thing I do after teleporting is pull a nearby lever to make a pillar rise and another fall in the area I fought that tree. Going to the left and taking out yet another asshole worm, I pick up this green statue, revealing a green light underneath it. I place a statue on the switch near the entrance to keep that cage lowered. Inside were yellow, red and blue statues and everything clicked. Taking the red statue to the red light is the easiest, thanks to the shortcut I made blowing up that boulder. Blue also uses that shortcut, I just have to walk the opposite direction from the red one. I can't do yellow just yet, I have to take green back. I put it on the lowered pillar from that lever near where I found the green statue in the first place, then go through all teleporting again to pull the lever again and lift it up. I also put the yellow statue on the other pillar when that is down. Both pillars aren't far from their respective statue slots. Once all statues are placed, it opens a gate to a statue emitting a beam in the back. I destroy it and that's one of the three dealt with. I'll go clockwise, next taking the route opposite this area's entrance. I burn down a fence and jump across the alternating platform to enter the next area. First thing I do here is run right to blow up a boulder. In the cave it unblocks, there's a green statue like the one in the last section. In the main section, I have three electric devices caged, an electric armadillo, and a tree guy making his branches attack me from the ground. To the left is a small creature that sticks its head out of the ground and spits at me before burrowing under again. First the tree. I jump attack its head, then slash its head again when it lowers. A few hits and I can capture the creatively named tree creature. Next is running around whacking that burrowing thing. It takes ages, but I eventually capture a nose needler. With the enemies out of the way, I carry that statue and place it on a switch in the area I was fighting that nose needler. This lowers the cages around the electric devices. The next step is to lure the electric armadillo into rolling into them. You can't use these ones as items, so it has to be done the hard way. Once they're all lit, it creates a bridge to the statue that when destroyed, gets rid of the second beam, just one left. Now for the room right at the entrance. I just have to jump attack a lantern to make the platform so the door appear. This is the simplest one of the lot. As I enter the room, the bridge to the statue fucks off. I get attacked by a group of new enemies. These are smiling burbles. They attack by biting, lunging and breathing toxic gas on me. I make sure to capture the first one I fight and kill all the rest. Next is a half brute and two skull swordsmen. Finally we have another of these guys from Anubis' temple. The one I fought there, I believe doesn't respawn, so this is my chance to capture it. However, I end up killing it by mistake. Its death makes the bridge come back and I can destroy that statue. I return to the main area where Keter is freed. She asks Sphinx to come with her while she returns to her husband, so he can thank him. The husband is of course overjoyed to see his wife safe. They are friends of Imhotep and he told him he wants to speak with Sphinx back at the Sun Shrine. He also gave the husband an Abydos pass card to give to him. Now I can get into the other half of Abydos I've been blocked off from all game. I place two of my Atonais in the skull outside their tent on South Beach. Then two more in the one on the western side of the main Heliopolis area. But before going to Imhotep, I have something else to deal with. I heard before I started this game that some enemies may be missable, so I want to check that the two enemies I killed aren't gone forever. This means I haven't saved since before I first spoke to Keter back in the tower. I run all the way back up and find they have respawned. I capture a sunflower, but the goat bastard kills me. This means all those puzzles I just did to free Keter, I have to do again. This time I do the enemy gauntlet first and I make sure to capture the big bull. Every other capture and item acquisition I also do again. But I do have to climb a little bit of a tower again just to burn this one wooden cage. I didn't have enough armadillos at the time. Back to Abydos next, for I have a lot of donating to do. Big bull first. This is my 10th donation which grants me a Monster Hunter certificate, bronze class. Then the rest. Crab hands, electric armadillo, green giant worm, half brute, knives cat, mummy chihuahua, mummy worm, nose needler, sharp beak. Skull swordsman is my 20th, which awards me with Monster Hunter certificate, silver class. Skull worshipper, smiling burble, spike spider, sunflower, tree creature. That's all of them. In one visit, I went from 9 donations to 25. Next, I fully cross the bridge leading to Khonsu's boat and show my pass to the guard. The guard warns me of the beast in the canal and says if I clear it out, he'll give me a portal amulet. Right away I see one of them, but it jumps in the water. I leave the area and come back to bring it back out, but accidentally kill it before I can capture it. So I enter one of the buildings and leave to respawn it, and a single hit is enough to capture a piranha. I then jump across the boardwalk to take on a grey one. It takes 3 hits before I'm able to capture an exo piranha. Third one is to the left and I kill it. I then jump across the gap to the right and take out the fourth. Near here is a tunnel I'll be using soon. I return to where I killed the third one and jump across this canoe to reach the fifth piranha. That's the last one. I climb up this nearby rope to find a guy with a pet goofy lizard. He says it was sold to him as very valuable, but it looks like he's been conned. He was hoping to impress his girlfriend with it, but now he needs something else. I return to the guard who gave me my task and get the Heliopolis amulet, so now I can teleport there using the portals. Around the corner from the guy with the lizard is another door I can enter. This is Tefnut's Target Tavern, which costs 10 scarabs per attempt. I just have to hit the targets to earn points. Hitting skulls loses points. For this game's medal, I need 40 points at least. Different targets worth different amounts, but I only get 21 points on my first try. Second try goes a little better at 30 points. But on my third attempt, I hit 40 points with 10 seconds left, then immediately hit a skull and have to scramble another 5 before time runs out. I manage it though. This gets me the marksman medal. After that, I go through the tunnel I pointed out earlier. A guy is pounding on the door of the council chambers, begging to be let in, but they refuse as I can't risk any monsters getting inside, so it looks like it's my job then. First new enemy just takes a few swings at me, but I get most of my swings in first and capture a wasp spider. It turns out all the council were afraid of was 4 wasp spiders. What a load of cowards. Once they're dead, they open the door to let in what I hope is a very resentful man. I then follow him inside myself. Running from the entrance to the bottom floor, there's a slot for a glyph key. One of the birdmen I can talk to thanks me for dealing with the spiders by giving me an eye to an eye. I go through the door in the back to the mayor's room. It turns out he's dying. His shifty aides are pushing him to choose a successor so he can give them the sacred crown of Abydos. A less shady doctor tells Sphinx that the mayor has contracted a mysterious illness. He needs 5 healing herbs to make a cure, but he can't leave the mayor in case his condition worsens, so I have to get him. He gives me a note to take to Kemet the inventor, who should be able to help me locate them. I grab the physician's note and get going to the museum so I can donate my exo-piranha, piranha, and wasp spider. Next I go to the higher up bridge above the canal and get the gate there opened. There was a building near here that I couldn't enter before. Outside it is Kemet and I can give him the note. He says that healing herbs can be found around Abydos, but are very fragile and die soon after being picked. They need to be kept in the medicine bag, but he doesn't have one. What he does have is a canopic vase, which he lets me have in case it helps. Time for one more visit to Tut. Menez is telling the fake Akhenaten that they've learned of an intruder now that 2 of the Abydos jewels have been recovered. He assumes it's an Urukite, one of the old inhabitants of Uruk. He sees them as no threat and has Menez strengthen security. He also has a new type of trap they've been testing on prisoners. It's a statue that transforms a target into a bat. Meanwhile, Basquiat shows up to revive Tut once more, and once more I climb out the usual hole. This time in this room, the camera focuses on an Anubis statue. I have to jump across the first 2 platforms as normal, and then sneak across a pillar to reach it. As soon as I get in front, it turns me into a bat. By mashing B, I can flap my wings for infinite flight. The only way to change back is to land in front of another statue with a green flame above it. Around this room is a pair of climbing and sneaking challenges to reach levers that open up the 2 doors at the end of the pit. I just need to use the bat to travel to each of them. Once that's done, I go through the door. It leads to the castle's exterior. I follow the path down a locked door, then cross a bridge to a statue that I push off a switch to remove one of its 2 locks. To find the other, I have to drop down to the left of the door and cross another bridge. Through the door is a room with an electrical device in the middle and a floor that is constantly flooding and draining. First I get in the corridor on the right, which shuts and electrifies me. I have to move quick to avoid the flooding and get to the device to turn it on. It lets free a water flow in another room, which also activates the moving rail I can hang on. Next is the corridor on the left, containing a chest holding the 3rd stone Abydos jewel. Collecting it lowers me into the fiery pit. I take the fire to a ladder right of this room's entrance and at the top I burn 3 cages for 35 onyx scarabs. Then it's riding the rail. I have to jump on the right end otherwise it will carry me through some water and make me lose my fire. But then a pillar on the way knocks me off and makes me land in water anyway. First thing I do in this new room is push a statue on top of the switch. There are 2 on either side and each switch raises a platform on that side. Next to that I can also pull a lever to open a door to the electric corridor. With that I can run through on fire and burn all these cages to bring my onyx scarab total up to 65. Then I jump across the platforms I rose on the right to burn this wood holding the pillar, which makes it drop a little. My next step is to get pulling these 3 levers to make the 3 platforms line up in front of a torch on the right so I can jump across it and light it. I then do the same for the torch on the left. Lighting them both opens a gate blocking another electric device. I line the platforms up with it and come back with electricity to activate it. It pushes back the wall on the platform above me. Next step is to drag that statue onto the left switch and burn the wood holding the pillar on that side up. With both pillars dropped, I can ride the rail again. Behind the right pillar is a lever that opens the front of 2 gates. Next is the left pillar hiding a lever that unlocks the other. I ride the rail around to the opposite side of the room where I got on it so I can light these 2 torches. Doing so unlocks the door between them. Right in front is a switch that opens a gate to another switch, but between that switch and the next is a pair of rotating statues with security lasers going around. Touching them undoes the switch. So I just have to move carefully and crouch when necessary to reach the next switch, which opens another. The third one opens one more gate to the first of 3 glyph keys I'll be needing. I get back on the rail and ride it into a third room with water. I pull a lever by the door which unlocks the door on the other side of the fire room. I then use the fire to burn more cages and get my onyx scarab total to 85. I leave this room for now and ride the rail back to that wall I pushed back above that lever. It bounces me across to those two gates I opened, getting me my second glyph key. I come back to the third room with electricity and activate the device there. It lowers a gate keeping me from a movable platform. Using these I can burn these two bits of wood holding up two more pillars. I can now ride the rail to the first pillar, run around the tunnel to the next while keeping my fire, and keep riding. I can then drop down to this wooden grate and burn through it to find the final glyph key. Then, across from the entrance to this entire area are slots for all the glyph keys. Placing them removes the barrier around this chest containing the medicine bag. Tut's role is complete for now and he dies again. Basket returns to Sphinx and gives him the bag and the jewel. The onyx scarabs from this visit bring my total to 230. Now I have the bag, I now have to find all the healing herbs. Then I remember that Imhotep wanted to talk to me, so I return to Heliopolis and see him. He says Anubis wants to see me again. He gives me a portal amulet that warps me right into Anubis Tower. And since there's a portal right behind Imhotep, it's not a problem. He has another quest to free some more people in the Cursed Palace. He wants the Sacred Crown of Abydos, which he gave to the mayor years ago. So now I have more incentive to save him. Now back to Abydos. I hand the third stolen jewel back over to the museum. This gets me my 8th gold ankh piece. The healing herbs are these green plants dotted around Abydos. I just have to walk up to each of them and select take to grab them. I can find 4 of them around town. Then outside the council chamber, I can get in the water and hit all 3 of these lanterns to spawn a chest containing a glyph key. I can use this inside to open a nearby gate leading to the final healing herb and a chest containing 100 gold scarabs. I go to the mayor and hand the herbs over to the physician who uses them to heal him. After thanking Sphinx for his help and asking why he's here, he does consider handing over the crown, but his shady advisors instead claim that Sphinx is the one who poisoned him in the first place. The mayor finally calls him out on being shady assholes. He needs to think first and invites Sphinx to join him next door, but the shady advisors follow him too. I return to the previous room and the mayor has finally decided to hand over the crown. But the shady advisors throw a temper tantrum and take the crown themselves. They escape through a hole under an Anubis statue, causing the mayor to beg Sphinx to stop them. And that cliffhanger is where I'm going to leave Sphinx and the Cursed Mummy this episode. At this point, I'm enjoying the game a lot more than I expected I would. The game will be finished next episode, so we'll see whether or not my opinion changed by the end. After the GTA 3 video, I was certain I'd be back to more reasonable video lengths. I thought 30, maybe 40 minutes at most of this video. I just can't help myself.